Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadra, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Christopher Leedy and Sarah Davis with Becker. Chris is of counsel to the firm and an active member of the staffing group. Chris has experience in drafting, maintaining, and negotiating client, employee, and contractor agreements, creating and implementing employee compensation and benefit plans, ensuring compliance with federal and state labor laws and regulations as it pertains to services delivered to all states, and drafting and maintaining and negotiating legal content in private and public contracts throughout the U.S., Canada, and the EU. Sarah is an associate of the firm's corporate department and business services group, where she focuses on mergers, acquisitions, and other commercial transactions. Sarah has been involved in private practice since 2015, specializing in the drafting and negotiation of complex financial agreement transactions, as well as while also representing clients in a wide variety of litigation matters at the Superior Appellate and Superior Court levels, or Supreme Court levels. Sarah also is an active member of the staffing group and has presented and provided thought leadership for various number of trade associations across the country. As one of the largest staffing practices in the nation, Becker LLC's clients span the spectrum of the industry in terms of size and market sector. Becker's team experience and focus provides a unique set of benefits, the Becker benefit, which assists their clients in making the right strategic and operational decisions. Clearly articulated written policies are an employee's go-to resource for guidance, clarification, and answers to basic employment questions. With all the changes being felt by both employees and employers as a result of the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, as well as a recent legislation passed in numerous states allowing recreational use of marijuana, updating your company policies has never been more critical. In today's Industry Insider webinar session here, Becker will discuss several recommended policy updates relating to the Equal Employment Opportunity Act and Americans with Disabilities Act in connection with COVID-19 pandemic and recent marijuana legislation, including reasonable accommodation requests, mandatory COVID-19 vaccine protocol and reporting requirements, and the use and legality of employer drug tests following the legislation of marijuana. With that, I will turn the floor over to both Sarah and Chris.
Thank you so much. Again, I'm Sarah Davis from Becker. I'm gonna start up here. I just wanna make sure that the slides, are working. Let's see. Perfect. Okay, thanks, Amanda. With what Amanda said, COVID basically is flipping the world upside down. We've all seen it. Also, along with new recent legislation being passed in regard to the recreational use of marijuana, it's just more important now than ever to be aware of guidance, rules, regulation, and law in each state that you're doing business with. So each state applicable to you, so that you can put appropriate policies into account for all these new changes. As you saw in the description of this webinar, and as explained by Amanda, we're gonna go over a few different things today. We're gonna go over policies under OSHA, which is the Occupational Safety and Health Administration. We're gonna go over a few policies from the EEOC, that's Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. We're also gonna go over some policies in regard to the ADA, the Americans with Disability Act, all that in regard to COVID-19. We're then gonna shift to a few new policies and rules that affect employers due to the new marijuana legislation that I'm sure everyone's heard all about. I just wanna stress, we're gonna touch on a few different states today, but it's important to be on top of all states applicable to you. Of course, you know, if you have a few specific questions that we don't touch upon today after, you can always reach out to me and Chris, our contact information is on the last page of the slide. So with that said, I think we should jump right in. So we're going to jump in with the recently released OSHA guidance. As stated under the OSHA Act, employers are responsible for providing a safe and healthy workplace free from recognized hazards likely to cause death and serious harm to their employees. The CDC recently did release an interim public health recommendation for fully vaccinated people that basically states, and I'm sure all of you feel it and you see it now as well, the masks are coming off, that fully vaccinated people can resume activities without wearing masks and without physical distancing, except where obviously required by federal state law, rules, and regulation. So the impact of this is, while most employees and employers are now vaccinated, employers have to remember that they must continue to take steps to protect unvaccinated or otherwise at-risk workers. So again, even though things are getting better and we're feeling optimistic about things, there's still going to be people who can't be vaccinated and are at risk. And employers really need to make sure they're still putting an effort to keep these individuals protected. In order to do this, employers should engage with workers and their representatives to determine how to implement multi-layered interventions. We're just going to go over a few basic recommended policies here. I'm sure you've heard of, and I'm sure a lot of your companies are already implementing for your return to work plan to make them go as seamless as possible. So for starters, granting paid time off for employees to get vaccinated is a big one. The Department of Labor and OSHA, as well as other federal agencies, as you know, they're working very diligently to make sure that everyone is able to get vaccinated. Businesses with fewer than 500 employees may also be eligible for tax credits under the American Rescue Plan if they provide this time off. And that's a big deal. It's been going on for a little while now, this tax credit. Chris, while we're on this topic, do you want to expand a little bit more?
Sure. So as we know, the 2020 FFCRA was passed in March of 2020, and that required employers with fewer than 500 employees to provide up to 2 weeks of paid sick leave and up to 10 weeks of paid expanded family and medical leave for qualifying COVID-19 related reasons. In exchange for doing this, employers were provided a refundable tax credit by the federal government that reimbursed them dollar for dollar for the cost of providing that leave. While the benefits under the FFCRA expire on March 31st of this year, however, obviously it was only voluntarily up until March 31st of this year. The mandatory nature of it stopped on December 31st of 2020. On March 11th, President Biden signed into law, the American Rescue Plan Act of 2021, which extended the grant of tax credits that were eligible through September 30th this year. For employers that voluntarily continue to provide federal COVID-19 paid sick leave and family benefits. We also want to note here too that there are states that are requiring COVID-19 leave. So if you're in one of those states, you may be eligible for the tax credits as well. In addition to the 6 reasons outlined originally in the FFCRA, for employers who voluntarily offer FFCRA leave, employees can now take and employers can thereby obtain a tax credit for paid leave for the following reasons: obtaining a COVID-19 vaccine, recovering from an injury, disability, or illness or condition related to the vaccine, or seeking or awaiting the result of a COVID-19 test or diagnosis when the employee has either been exposed to COVID-19 or the employer has requested it. It's important that company policies, including your handbook, indicate whether the company is going to partake in these additional voluntary leave benefits, and if so, the procedure for its employees to request such time off, and a clear indication of when these voluntary benefits will cease, even if it's the same date that the American Rescue Plan Act expires, which is September 30th.
Awesome. Thanks, Chris. And I apologize, I'm coming off of a little cold, so my voice is going. So if I go in and out, I'm sorry. But getting back into the protections for unvaccinated and at-risk workers, employees can instruct workers who are infected, unvaccinated workers who've had close contact with someone who's tested positive for COVID-19, and all workers with COVID-19 symptoms to stay home. I know it seems like an easy thing, but it should be encouraged. What comes with that is that employers must ensure, do their best to make sure people know that it's an option and ensure that absence policies are non-punitive. And again, this goes hand in hand with the above. You should be sure to eliminate or revise policies that encourage workers to come to work sick or when unvaccinated workers have been exposed to COVID-19. And I know it's hard, you know, to get people to come to work, but again, they do have the tax credit that Chris spoke about. So at least, you know, you're giving this leave time, your company will, if they qualify, get that tax credit. So that's at least a little benefit from that. Again, and this is a big one that you've been hearing literally for years now, implement physical distancing for unvaccinated and otherwise at-risk workers in the communal workspace. A key way to protect unvaccinated workers is to physically distance them from other unvaccinated or otherwise at-risk workers. Generally, you know, this is the 6 feet we've heard about for so long now, although you know it's not a guarantee, especially if the workspace is not one that's very well ventilated. So that's another factor to consider. Employers could also limit the number of unvaccinated or otherwise at-risk workers in one place at a given time. For example, and again, we've been doing this for a long time now, implement flexible work hours when you can, rotate stagger shifts when you can, delivering services remotely is a big one, implementing flexible meetings. Again, this is just so important because everyone has been doing these things, but now that the vaccine is here, again, everyone's feeling optimistic. It's important to understand that in reality, there are still many unvaccinated workers, at-risk workers, so it's going to take a little bit of time to get back to that normalcy that we all crave. So we just need to keep that in the back of our head as employers that, you know, you want to let up, but you still have this obligation to keep people, to keep the individuals safe. Providing unvaccinated otherwise at-risk workers with face coverings, we've been doing that. Employers should provide face coverings to unvaccinated otherwise at-risk workers at no cost. I think what we have to get into is that we should be providing these face masks. There should be no negative, if someone wants to wear their own PPE equipment and anything like that, there should be no negative feelings, no comments such as, you know, well, we're vaccinated, why are you doing that? We need to encourage everyone to feel comfortable. Another big one, obviously, is to educate and train workers on your COVID-19 back to work policies and procedures in accessible formats and language that everybody understands. Train managers on how COVID-19 policies, communicate supportive workplace policies clearly and frequently via multiple methods, meetings, emails, just make sure you're getting it clear what your policies are and make sure everyone understands these policies. Communications, again, should be in plain language, understood by all. You should communicate basic facts about how it spread, what you're doing to prevent spread and make everyone feel comfortable. It's just crucial that workers understand their rights to a safe and healthy work environment. They also need to know who to contact with questions and conversations about safety concerns. You can do all this stuff, but if there's a safety concern, you need to have a policy in place of who they report this to, who can they communicate to. And they need to know that they can communicate these concerns. If there's something happening that they're nervous about, they can talk to someone without any fear of retaliation. You have to make sure that supervisors are familiar with the workplace policies as well. And also, I forgot to mention another good policy to put in place. And again, I'm sure everyone's doing this already, is performing routine cleaning and disinfections. If someone's in the facility within 24 hours, it's a good idea to get disinfections. Again, this is good policy. It also helps people feel comfortable at work, which is, you know, a big thing.
Yeah, thanks, Sarah. And then another crucial step is the implementation of protections from retaliation and probably setting up an anonymous process for workers to voice their concerns about COVID-19 related hazards. Ms. Rowe, you do want to be mindful of Section 11C of the OSHA Act, which prohibits discharging or in any other way discriminating against any employee for engaging in protected activities under OSHA. Some examples of violations of 11C include discriminating against employees for raising a reasonable concern about infection control related to COVID-19 to either the employer, the employer's agent, other employees, government agency, or even to the public, right? Whether it's through print, online, social media, or any other type of media, or taking any action against an employee for voluntarily providing their own PPE, not PPP, PPE. In addition, you absolutely want to notify workers of their rights to a safe and healthy work environment. And you want to know let the workers know who to contact with questions or concerns about workplace safety, and that there are prohibitions against retaliation for raising any kind of concerns or engaging in any other type of protected activity under OSHA. And then finally, you definitely want to, if you can, if it's possible, have an anonymous hotline where employees can voice their concerns freely without fear of retaliation, right? The more you promote that open door policy, the more likely that employee is to report a concern. You're likely to find out about a violation that you have obviously want to get ahead of, because you don't want OSHA coming knocking on your door. You don't want a private lawsuit brought against you. So again, welcoming input from employees by using the anonymous hotline is a very good idea that we suggest.
Thanks, Chris. Did I say PPP before? I probably did. I meant PPE. So many PPP things coming in. I feel like that was probably me. But all right, Chris, thanks for that. As explained, while the above are clearly important steps to consider for integration into your policies, they're guidelines. So they're without legal obligations. They're a good idea. And if down the road anything was to come up, if you're following these guidelines, it looks good. Again, though, they're not legal obligations. However, what is required is recording and reporting of COVID-19 illnesses. So under mandatory OSHA rules now, employers are responsible for recording work-related cases of COVID-19 illness on OSHA's Form 300 logs if the following requirements are met. So the first one, it has to be a confirmed case of COVID-19 for this reporting obligation. The case has to involve one or more relevant recording criteria, including medical treatment beyond first aid needed, days away from work, restricted work or transfer to another job, and the case must be work-related. So this is the factor that's a little more tricky, and you need to consider different elements of it. A case is work-related when an event or exposure in the work environment either caused or significantly aggravated the underlying condition. For example, it's likely work-related when several cases develop among workers who work closely together and there's no alternative explanation. It's also likely work-related if it's contracted shortly after lengthy close exposure to a particular customer or coworker who has a confirmed case of COVID-19. And again, there are no alternative explanations. It's likely work-related if an employer's job duties include having frequent close exposure to the general public in a locality with ongoing community transmission. And again, no alternative explanation. However, it's likely not work-related if the worker is the only worker to contract COVID-19 in the worker's vicinity and the job duties do not include having frequent contact with the general public. And it's likely not work-related if the worker outside the workplace is exposed to someone during the period in which the individual is likely infectious. So again, you have to consider any evidence of causation as well provided by medical providers, public health authorities, and the employer himself or herself to get the situation to see, is this what could be considered a work-related illness that must be reported?
Yep. And Sarah, it's also worth noting that this past April, OSHA also stated that an adverse reaction to a vaccine would be a recordable event if the reaction met the definition of a recordable injury, which you just discussed. But it's also important to note too that OSHA does distinguish between a voluntary vaccine and a mandatory vaccine. If the vaccine that is received is voluntary, right, under the employer's program, the employer does not need to record an adverse action on the OSHA 300 log. Some of the factors that OSHA will consider in determining if the vaccine is truly voluntary include if the choice to accept or reject the vaccine affects the employee's employment, or if the employee experiences any kind of negative treatment from not receiving the vaccine. And that can include not being able to return to the workplace, or as extreme as terminating the employee for refusal. obviously employers should continue to report outbreaks to public health departments as they are required to, and support ongoing contract tracing efforts as well.
Right, so I think that's the important takeaway. The first few things we spoke about, the policies recommendation, this is required. This is a reporting requirement. So it's you need to be aware of that. And then I think, Chris, your last comments about mandatory vaccinations, a good time to move for us to move from OSHA to policies under the EEOC and ADA. While companies should already have established, clearly articulated EEO and American disability policies, these policies really should be further expanded now to include accommodation requests and other protocols related to COVID-19, just because can't get away from it. Under the ADA, a reasonable accommodation is a change in the work environment, which allows an individual with a disability to continue to perform a job's essential functions and or enjoy equal benefits and privileges of employment. The ADA requires employers to provide reasonable accommodations to qualified employees unless doing so imposes an undue hardship. So an undue hardship is generally defined as an action requiring significant difficulty or expense by the employer, or which would cause extensive, substantial disruption to the business. So give an example of this. Say it's a company that very, very small company, 2 or 3 people in the company. Someone, you know, due to a disability has a reason they can't work full time. So reasonable request is now they have to go part-time. Can they hire someone else? Is that going to be a financial burden that they can take on? Is that something that's going to be so disruptive, having someone else come on? So it's something like that. The burden is on the employer to prove undue hardship, which again is determined on a case-by-case basis after considering a number of objective factors. Again, the nature and cost of the accommodation in relation to the size, resources, nature and structure of the employee's operation. Is their accommodation request just so outside of what is possible for this business, it would just completely disrupt the business? Some examples of reasonable COVID-19 accommodations that we've been seeing, and I'm sure you guys have been seeing as well, and that we've already spoken about, is the use and providing of protective equipment, shift changes to the workstations to limit exposure to other, and teleworking when possible. However, there's always a caveat. Some disabilities may pose a direct threat to health and safety of individuals in the workplace, with no reasonable accommodations available to negate these threats. In this event, many players can cite a direct threat defense. This is certainly a hot topic right now, as it's the basis for the argument of mandatory employee vaccinations. For example, an employer may be able to establish that having an employee who is unable to receive a vaccine in a job that requires close contact with other people, travel, poses a significant risk of viral transmission that cannot be reduced by means. If you have someone in the job description going out there and being close contact, you can't do teleworking. You can't, you know, some of these accommodations are not available. And if they're not available, then that's a direct threat. So just to go tying this in and diving back into the mandatory vaccine topic a little more, according to the EEOC, employers can generally adopt a policy that requires employees to be vaccinated as a condition to entering the workforce. However, employers also must attempt to accommodate employees who, due to disabilities or sincerely held religious beliefs, decline or refuse the vaccine. For example, if they can't get the vaccine, again, the same type of accommodations. Well, can we negate this risk by wearing a face mask? Can we negate this risk by social distancing, modified shift, teleworking? Can they accept a reassignment? You have to go through these before saying there's a direct threat that we cannot negate. Also, while mandatory vaccination programs are permissible, they must comply with the requirements of the ADA. In analyzing whether an employee is a direct threat, the guidance directs an employer to, again, it's a fact-by-fact basis, the type of work environment, such as whether the employee works alone or with others, whether that employee works inside or outside, that's a big deal. Available ventilation, as we talked about, the frequency and duration of the direct interaction the employee typically has with other employees and non-employees. Another big one is the number of partially or fully vaccinated individuals already in the workplace. If you have a workplace that, you know, they're the only person unvaccinated, that's a factor. If there's a lot of unvaccinated people, that's a factor too. Are employees wearing face masks? Do they need to wear face masks? Are they voluntarily wearing face masks? Are they going, are they doing routine screening? Is there space available for social distancing? These are all factors that need to be considered. A conclusion that there's a direct threat would include a termination, that the unvaccinated individual will expose others to the virus at the work site. If an employee determines that an individual who cannot be vaccinated due to disability poses a direct threat, again, you need to go through, you can't just exclude the individual, the employee. You can't just terminate them. You must go through extensive factor analysis to make sure that there's no other way to negate the threat. And that's the only time that this direct threat defense is really going to work in your favor. So now that I've gone through the vaccine and what's permitted, Chris, can you expand a little more on specific vaccine protocol?
Sure. So employers who administer the COVID vaccine to employees, either directly or through a third-party contract that they have with that third party, regardless of whether it's on a mandatory or voluntary basis, have also been seeking guidance on regarding what pre-vaccination questions are permissible under the ADA. In this regard, generally, the ADA restricts the circumstances in which employers may ask or may require medical examinations. Medical examinations are defined as procedures or tests that seek information about an individual's physical or mental impairments or health, or if they make disability-related inquiries, which these are questions that are likely to elicit information about an individual's disability. The EEOC's guidance does distinguish between a mandatory employer-administered vaccination program and a voluntary program, though. For employers who require employees to receive the COVID vaccine from the employer or its agent, i.e. a mandatory vaccination program, the EEOC has confirmed that the ADA's restrictions apply to screening questions that must be asked immediately prior to administering the vaccine. So prior to administering the vaccine, there are certain questions that employees or anybody receiving the vaccine has to answer. And if the employer is administering it, the employer must ask these questions. because these questions are likely to elicit information about a disability, the ADA requires that these questions have to be job related and consistent with business necessity. To meet this standard, an employer has to show a reasonable belief based on objective evidence that an employee who does not answer the questions and therefore doesn't receive the vaccine will pose a direct threat, which Sarah just talked about, to the employee's own health or safety or to the health or safety of the others in the workplace. Therefore, when an employer requires that employees be vaccinated by the employer or his agent, the employer should be aware that the employee may be eligible to challenge the mandatory pre-vaccination inquiries, and the employer would then have to justify those questions under the ADA. However, there are two circumstances you can get around asking these, we'll call them impermissible inquiries. The first option is basically making the program truly voluntary, right? That you make it voluntary for the employee to answer the questions and voluntary for them to receive the vaccine. If you make it that program that voluntary, as I just stated, you cannot retaliate, intimidate, or threaten the employee for refusing to answer any questions or thereby receiving the vaccine. Second, I think really is the better option where most employers are going, is if the employee receives an employer required vaccine from a third party that does not have a contract with the employer, right? So their pharmacy, their doctor, or any other healthcare provider, the ADA is job related and consistent with business necessity standard does not come into play because those questions are not being asked by the employer or the employer's agent. If the employee cannot get vaccinated because of a disability or because of a sincerely held religious belief, and there is no reasonable accommodation possible, then and only then would it be lawful for the employer to exclude the employee from the workplace. Likewise, too, after the direct threat, if there's a direct threat that cannot be reduced to an acceptable level, again, you can exclude the employee from the work, from physically entering the workplace. However, that doesn't mean you can automatically terminate the worker, right? Employers are going to have to determine if there are any other rights that apply to the employee under applicable EEO laws or any other federal, state, or local laws or regulations. For example, right, if an employer excludes an employee based on an inability to accommodate that person to be exempt from the vaccine requirement, the employer may be entitled to accommodations such as working in the current position remotely. This is the same steps that employers took when excluding them from the workplace due to a COVID-19 diagnosis or symptoms. Some workers may be entitled to telework and some may not, right? It doesn't fit. If you're a day laborer, obviously it just doesn't work, right? If you're an office worker, maybe it does work, maybe it doesn't work. If you're routinely taking calls, greeting people, obviously if that's essential function of your job, you cannot make that accommodation. And you also have to keep in mind too, they may be entitled to leave, right? There are certain states that expressly say that a reasonable accommodation is unpaid leave. There's also court cases out there that say unpaid leave is a reasonable accommodation. Indefinite leave is never a reasonable accommodation, but again, leave can be unpaid, or they can take leave under FMLA, state leave policies, or any other employer policies that the employer has in place.
Right. I think the takeaway here is that employers and employees should engage and need to engage in flexible interactive process to identify the different workplace accommodation options that do not constitute an undue hardship, which is the significant difficulty or expense. Employers may rely on the CDC recommendations when deciding whether an effective accommodation that would pose an undue hardship is available. Employers also should consult applicable OSHA standards and guidance. Again, they're guidance, but you know, if you're doing these things that they recommend, if anything should come up down the road, it looks good that you're abiding by these recommendations. Also, managers and supervisors need to be reminded that it's unlawful to disclose that an employee is receiving an unreasonable accommodation or retaliate against an employee for requesting an accommodation. And it also just must be remembered that, again, I just want to stress it, that the EEOC is looked to for guidance, not law. So there's no telling which way a court's going to go if there was a dispute brought into litigation. But again, if you're following recommended policies, if you're putting things in place to protect workers, if you're following these protocols for the vaccines, it's going to be better for you down the road. So again, they're not some of them. I mean, we have talked about mandatory protocol here, but even the non-mandatory ones, it's just a good idea to update your policies to incorporate these guidelines.
Yeah. And then Sarah, one more thing before we move away from this topic. It's worth noting that the EEOC just recently and really finally issued guidance that employers can offer incentives to employees to voluntarily provide documentation or other confirmation of a vaccination received from an independent third party. Again, your pharmacies, your doctors. Howard, they did remind you that any information or documentation collected by the employers must be maintained confidentially under the ADA. In regards to the incentives themselves, employers can offer incentives to employees for voluntarily requiring a vaccine administered by the employer or its agent, so long as the incentive is not so substantial as to be coercive, right? But the EEOC, of course, does not define what substantial means. So we're all kind of trying to figure that out.
Did they define substantial? No.
No. So we're all trying to figure that out. I think it's really case by case basis. They did explain, though, a very large incentive could make employees feel pressured to disclose protected medical information. So obviously, if you're providing a huge bonus to someone, and huge is, I guess it's relative, right? You're on the West Coast, the Midwest, East Coast, you know, a dollar isn't the same everywhere. So you really want to be looking towards legal counsel when you're developing an incentive program if you're going to go that way. Also, employers can offer an employee's family member an opportunity to be vaccinated too, if certain conditions are met, but they cannot require employees, family members to be vaccinated. With that said, employers can offer an incentive to employees to provide documentation or other confirmation from a third party, not acting on the employer's behalf, that the employer, the employee's family members have been vaccinated. However, an employer may not offer any incentives to an employee in exchange for a family member's receipt of the vaccine from an employer or its agent, as that would violate the Genetic Information Act, or GINA. So you want to steer clear of that, but incentives at this time are definitely allowed. It's just a matter of how much of an incentive you want to provide.
Got it. Thanks, Chris. So moving on to our next topic here. Let me make sure I'm in the right PowerPoint because I was behind a little bit there. Legalizing the recreational use and purchase of marijuana has been a very hot topic this year, 2021, as many states have passed or are considering now passing legislation allowing for this. Can you just, Chris, give a little bit of how this is going to affect employers?
Yep. So as Sarah said, within the first half of this year alone, states following the lead of states like Nevada, at least 4 states and 1 city have passed laws legalizing or at least decriminalizing recreational marijuana or preventing drug testing with regards to marijuana. So first one, in New York, the Cannabis Marijuana Regulation and Taxation Act was passed on March 31st of this year. Under that act, employers are not able to make any hiring decision based on a positive cannabis test. In other words, employers cannot reject an applicant based solely on the positive cannabis test results, but they can still test for it. For employees, an adverse action is only permitted if the person is impaired, or if the action is required by state or federal law, or if the failure to take such action would require the employer to be in violation of any federal contract or federal funding. So basically, unless one of the exceptions applies, it may be a waste of time and money to have pre-employment marijuana testing. You also want to note in this regard, in New York City, employers have been banned since May 10th of 2020 from testing for or doing pre-employment drug testing for cannabis. Also, New York is kind of special too. Most states have an exception for safety sensitive positions. New York has no such exception. So if you're doing business in New York, something very much to be mindful of. New Jersey, not to be outdone by New York, also has passed the New Jersey Cannabis Regulatory Enforcement Assistance and Marketplace Modernization Act. That's not enough, that how long their name of the act is. This act also prohibits employers from refusing to hire or employ any person or discharging from employment or taking any other adverse action against a person solely because of that person's use of recreational marijuana. It also further prohibits an employer from taking adverse action against an employee or applicant due solely to the presence of cannabinoid metabolites in the employee system. As far as testing during employment, New Jersey's, and it's gonna be very difficult in New Jersey. An adverse action is only permitted following a positive test if the employer's testing program uses a scientific method. So that's gonna be your saliva, urine, blood. So that's easy enough. The second part here is really, really the hard part. Also, a certified workplace impairment expert has conducted a physical evaluation of the employee and determined that the employee is currently under the influence of marijuana. So basically, you're either gonna have to have somebody who's a certified workplace impairment expert on staff.
Do we know how someone gets that job, what these qualifications are?
No, yeah. The regulations haven't come out yet. But you're gonna have to have one of them on your staff. You're gonna have to have a contractor on standby, obviously relatively close to your place of business or your client work site. Or I would think that hospitals, doctors would hopefully have those experts available so you could bring the employee to one of those sites. You can in New Jersey test for, you can test applicants and employees under the following circumstances, but you still have to comply with the adverse action requirements that I just talked about. So that's going to be for pre-employment screenings upon reasonable suspicion of an employee's usage while engaging in their work responsibilities, finding any observable signs of intoxication related to cannabis items. As part of the employer's regular screening of current employees, determining use during an employee's prescribed work hours, and following a work-related accident that employer is investigating. So like New York, you can test for marijuana in New Jersey unless you fall within a limited exception, but you cannot refuse to hire or employ a person, discharge them, or take any adverse action because of a positive test. So again, it's almost to the point, what is the point of testing them unless they're visibly high, right? Sarah, can you provide a few more examples for our audience?
Sure. So let's start with Philadelphia. So in Philadelphia, the city council passed an ordinance making it an unlawful employment practice for an employer, labor organization, employment agency, or agent thereof to require a prospective employee to submit to testing for the presence of marijuana in such prospective employee's system as a condition for employment. However, unlike New York, it does not apply to police officers or other law enforcement provisions, any position requiring commercial driver's license, any position requiring the supervision or care of children, medical patients, disabled, or other vulnerable individuals, or any position in which the employee could significantly impact the health or safety of other employees. So it does have this safety exception. Additionally, it does not apply to any federal, state, statute, regulation, or order that requires drug testing. So if there's a specific statute in place, the drug testing is not prohibited. Right, and then going to, in Virginia is next, we'll talk about Virginia. Amendment to existing law now provides employment protections for medical marijuana cardholders by prohibiting employers from terminating, disciplining, or otherwise discriminating against employers for lawful use of cannabis oil pursuant to valid written certification. So while the statute provides anti-retaliation protections for an employee's lawful use of cannabis oil, it does not restrict an employer's ability to take adverse action for an employee's impairment while at work. So that's a big one. It does not require an employee to commit any act that would cause the employer to be in violation of federal law or result in the loss of any federal contract or funding, or require any defense industrial-based sector employee or prospective employer to hire or retain any applicant or employee who tests positive for marijuana in excess of specific specified amounts. That's Virginia. I'm going to do maybe two more. In New Mexico, the law allows employers to test for marijuana, but has protections for medical marijuana users, which means employers with limited exceptions are prohibited from taking adverse actions against applicants and employees who have a prescription for and or use medical marijuana. And then in Montana, the governor just signed legislation that will provide protection for off-duty use of marijuana. Since the applicable ballot initiative does not provide employment-related protections and focuses on employer restrictions of on-duty use of drugs, this newly signed law still permits employers to take action based on use of marijuana while working, which, as we see, is pretty common. However, employers should take note that this new bill also amends the lawful off-duty conduct statute, which is important. So as revised, marijuana will be considered a lawful product. So under the law, employers may not refuse to hire or discriminate against an individual with respect to compensation, promotion, or the terms, conditions, or privileges of employment because the individual legally uses marijuana off premise. So for, like you said before, Chris, for employers with drug testing programs, it's going to be difficult to take adverse employment actions for positive marijuana tests, particularly for pre-employment and random drug screenings, because, you know, you take a screening, when did they use this marijuana? It's hard to prove that it was off-duty versus, you know, on-duty. So, Chris, can you just provide some examples of what policies and contractual provisions should be in place in light of these legislative changes? Chris, We can't hear you.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I apologize.
But no.
So despite what we just talked about, you want to keep in mind, right, that there, you can still have a drug-free workplace. It's still especially allowed, and you should still absolutely maintain that policy. For example, if someone's caught with drugs in the workplace, that would be a violation, terminable offense, right? Also, as what can be probably gleaned from what Sarah and I have talked about, this is an area of law that's really still developing. So creating policy that adheres to the law is obviously going to differ from state to state. And in the future, it's going to require more changes to your policy. So it's really going to be a fluid, it's going to be the definition of a fluid policy. So with that said, there's two general types of policies. You have your zero tolerance policies and you have your tolerance policies. Zero tolerance policies are never looked upon favorably by the EEOC, in most cases the courts. However, some industries and companies will need to apply zero tolerance policies, especially in those safety sensitive industries, depending on what state you're in, or if they're performing work as a federal contractor, because almost, I think actually all legislation throughout the country does allow for that. In all other cases, you may want to consider a tolerance policy. For instance, a company may be in the IT industry, right, where marijuana may not affect a worker's ability to perform, or the company's neo culture may lend itself to implementation of a more tolerant policy, right? And if you're out San Francisco, everybody's things, they're more acceptable. Drug use is more acceptable in some places, is basically the point there. The following, so there's a, I'm going to give you a couple examples, one of a good policy to have, one of a better policy to have. The first one is the use of any drug while employed by a company is not permitted. In no event will drug use be permitted. This is a poor policy for a lot of reasons, right? However, two of the most important reasons is it's overly broad. It doesn't define what type of drugs are legal. For example, are prescription drugs illegal? Like anti-anxiety pills should be permitted depending on what type of impairment it may cause and the position that the person is working in. And also, I think most importantly, it doesn't speak to the ADA's interactive process, which we discussed before, which is you sitting down with the person, seeing what other accommodations can be made instead of taking the type of drug that you're discussing with the employee. The following is a better example. Illegal drug use is not permitted. Use of prescription drugs may be permitted in the discretion of the employer, so long as the drugs do not affect the employee's work. The prescription drugs are legal under federal and or state laws, and the prescription drug is able to be verified to the employer by the prescribing medical professional. Further, should the use of properly prescribed drugs be legal under state and or federal law, the employer will engage in an interactive process with the employee to identify alternatives to the prescription drug and or any reasonable accommodation. So in this example, we're separating valid prescription use versus illegal drug use. Further, the policy does give the employer latitude to enforce the policy of not permitting prescription drug use in certain circumstances. And finally, again, importantly, it discusses the interactive process so to avoid any kind of litigation or issues under the ADA. And I think it's very important to note, and I think it kind of goes without saying, but I'm going to say it anyway. Companies have to apply their policies consistently and lawfully, right? Consistently meaning that each employee is treated in a similar manner for the position applied for. Lawfully meaning that companies should avoid implementing a policy which may have a disparate impact. You may not mean to have it, but it may affect a protected group of individuals under various anti-discrimination laws. So you have to take a step back, look, say, is this policy affecting a certain group that may otherwise be protected under law? A clear and consistent policy, which you apply on a regular basis, absolutely will help you in a defense case regarding a wrongful termination. And also, I think it's also important to speak to client contracts, right, surrounding use of marijuana and all these new laws coming out. You definitely want to have a compliance with laws provision where the client is representing and warranting that they will be in full compliance with all applicable laws. Right, this should help prevent an instance where a client requires a drug test, which may or may not be permitted under state law or local law, or when a client takes an adverse action or forces you to take an adverse action because of a failed drug test in violation of law. If that happens, hopefully you have an indemnification provision which states that they will defend you and hold you harmless from any violations of law or any of their breaches of the contract. That way, if you're sued by an aggrieved employee or applicant, you can seek indemnification from the client and you're not coming out of your own pocket. Sarah, is there anything else you'd like to add to this?
So I think we really should add consent forms. So it's highly recommended that these policies be signed and acknowledged prior to any drug testing. A consent form which permits the company to obtain the test results and share them with a third party should also be signed as well. This is an issue that not a lot of people actually think about. What happens if there's a positive test? Are you able to provide the record or notification to the end client? So something that, you know, really should be considered. The Equal Employment Opportunity Commission does state if the results of a drug test reveal the presence of a lawfully prescribed drug or other medical information, such information must be treated as confidential medical records. So again, you know, these still are medical records that we're dealing with. So they still need to be treated confidentially. That's why the consent forms are good as well. With that said, most companies won't be subject to HIPAA unless the employee is a patient of a covered entity under HIPAA. However, obviously, prudence is always best in these types of situations. As such, it is highly recommended that companies obtain a consent form from applicants and employees to permit the company to release the information of the test being performed. To this end, as a best practice, it's suggested to have employees' medical records separate from their personnel files. That way, in the event there's an audit, a subpoena, any type of situation where you need to produce your records, the subject company does not permit these confidential medical records to be disclosed. So but one thing I would add to that, just to get the consent.
I was just going to talk real briefly about that. Sure. Switching back to COVID and the mandatory testing, there was recently a case that came out of Texas. It was decided rather fast. That case in Texas involved a hospital system that announced to 26,000 of its employees that they all needed to receive a COVID-19 vaccination as a condition of staying employed. The hospital gave employees only a couple of narrow exemptions based on either a medical condition or obviously your sincerely held religious belief. More than 100 nurses and other healthcare employees filed suit against the hospital, claiming that it was unlawful for them to require the vaccine. That case was then removed from state court to federal court because of the FDA's statute regarding emergency use authorization classifications. So notably, the hospital won in that case. The courts dismissed the case, stating that Texas law only protects employees from being terminated for refusing to commit an act carrying criminal penalties to the worker, and receiving a COVID vaccination is not an illegal act and it carries no criminal penalties. So it didn't apply there. So, but notably in Texas, there's no public policy exception to at-will employment that many or most states do have. So the court said, the court said, even if Texas did have that, the vaccine policy is consistent with public policy, namely protecting workers and patients. Again, this is probably a little different than most professions because it is a hospital. However, as far as the emergency use authorization claim, the court said it didn't apply to private employers or allow for a private clause of action. You want to remember that this statute governing the ADA states that those receiving an emergency vaccine must be informed of the option to accept or refuse the administration of the product, of the consequences, if any, are refusing administration of the product and of the alternatives to the product that are available and of their benefits and risks, right? So that was the key there. However, they said no private cause of action doesn't apply to private employers. Basically what happened was the legal claim there brought by the nurses required them to demonstrate that receiving a COVID-19 vaccination was a crime. Obviously they could not prove that, right? Keep in mind, again, other states have much broader protections against wrongful discharge in violation of public policy that might provide a better basis under which to bring up wrongful discharge claim. Think if you're in a red state, probably not so much. More blue you go, the more public policy exceptions you're going to have. Also, some states do see vaccination status differently. Back to Montana again, they became the first jurisdiction to recognize an individual's vaccination status as a protected category. The Montana law also prohibits employers from requiring employees to disclose their immunization status and bars employers from requiring employees to receive vaccines still in the FDA's preliminary emergency use authorization status. So if this claim was brought in Montana, the employees would have won, is basically probably what employees probably might have won in a lot of places. Texas was just not a good starting point for them. And then I think that's it for us.
Yeah, you know what? I apologize. My first time using the Cisco, and I think we have a question. I'm trying to figure out. Would that, let's see, says, I'm not sure.
Sure, I can read it off for you. Okay. The question was, they're a local company in Michigan, and as far as they're aware, employers can still enact a zero tolerance policy despite marijuana being legal. Is that correct?
Yes, and that's my understanding. I would agree that yes, they can still have a zero tolerance policy.
Okay, and now for anyone else that has questions, please go ahead and submit a chat or Q&A while we're wrapping things up here today. I do have another question that has come in, and it is related to vaccines, and if you can provide any guidance, or is there any guidance available on employers during the application process regarding asking for vaccination status?
Yeah, so it's not a medical inquiry. They come out and say asking for proof of a vaccine is not a medical inquiry, so it would not trigger the ADA. I would still caution employers when they're asking that question, because the EEOC said that. Again, the EEOC is guidance, it is not law. I could definitely see a more liberal court, or more a court venued in a more liberal state, even a state court or liberal circuit court, stating something differently. Right. So again, if you're in Texas, I would feel pretty good about that. You're in California, I wouldn't feel so good about that.
Okay, great. And then as it relates to the OSHA responsibility and reporting requirement, for staffing agencies who have contractors or employees that are out at a customer site, can you explain the relationship of the reporting requirement in that scenario?
So they're still going to be your employees, right? It depends on what your contract says. I mean, having who's responsible for the safety, who's responsible for the reporting. If the client doesn't report it, you're going to have to report it. It's going to come back on your log. So you start with the contract and you work your way back from there. If the client doesn't report it, you're going to have to report it.
Okay. And are there any final thoughts or guidance that you'd like to provide the audience as we wrap up today's session?
No, I think just, you know, making sure that your clients are familiar with mandatory COVID vaccines, because I have had calls from clients, or we have had calls from clients stating that their clients are requiring mandatory vaccines, you know, how to go about that process. I think since this started, having compliance with laws provision is extremely important, right? Making sure that they know that their obligations under the law, and that they can't force you to do something that would be impermissible under law. So if they can say employees that you're providing have to be vaccinated, making sure that they're willing to enter into the interactive discussion with them, what kind of accommodations can be made? Because it's not just obviously you, it could be a joint employer status. You're going to end up one being sued. They're going to end up being sued. So then again, it's going to go back to your contract too. Who's indemnifying who? Do you have the provision? I know a lot of people like those one pagers. Those one pagers don't have your needed compliance with laws or your indemnification limitation and liability provisions. So keep that in mind.
I agree.
Good point. And if you have any additional questions that you'd like to speak to Becker one-on-one, both Chris and Sarah's contact information is up on the screen, so feel free to reach out to them directly. We will also have a recording of today's session available on our website for anyone that you'd like to share this presentation with, or if you'd like to revisit it. With that, I'd really like to thank Chris and Sarah for taking the time to speak to our audience here today and cover, you know, how to update your policies and the discussion about, you know, the recent marijuana legislation. So thank you all for joining us, and I hope to see you guys again soon.
Thank you so much.
Bye. Have a great day.
Bye.